quiet notes and loud notes. This is one of the aspects that makes music interesting. You don't even think about that when you play or hear a real instrument, but in a digital realm such things need to be emulated, otherwise an instrument would sound dull. And parameter that is responsible for different keys pressure emulation is called a velocity. Velocity is just one of the characteristics of MIDI notes, and it allows us not only to play a MIDI instrument in a real way, but also makes it possible for melodic parts written as MIDI notes to sound humanized. But here is a very unexpected question. Can velocity be misused? So in other words, can you ruin your work using velocity? And the answer is yes, if you are an Ableton user and you want to try to apply a velocity to a sampled instrument. I'm Alex, and today we will be demystifying one of the parameters in Ableton that is responsible for velocity application. So if you want to know how and why you may run into trouble using velocity and how to put it fully under your control, stay tuned. So what is a sampled instrument just to begin with? Well, let's imagine you have a piano and you love it so much that you would literally want to put it into all of your projects. So the problem is that piano is a huge instrument and you cannot take it everywhere you go. So one day you decide to sample it. So you open your DAW, set up your mics and start recording. You press a key and you record it. You press another key and you record it. And you do that 88 times until all the keys are recorded as individual audio samples. But how do you apply that into your project? Well, you would load all the samples into some dedicated tools in Ableton, for example, to a drum rack, which allows you to map individual sounds to individual keys on a piano roll. But what would automatically happen is that Ableton would wrap each of the samples into a shell called a Simpler. Simpler is actually one of the two instruments of Ableton that can handle complex work with external samples. It has a lot of controls, but today we will be focusing on just two of them. And they are called volume and velocity to volume. The first parameter is straightforward because it allows you to boost or cut some volume from a loaded sample, which sometimes comes handy. But the second one is so mysterious that you can hardly find any information about it, neither in internal Ableton's help nor in Google. What is even more interesting is that by default, Simpler loads with volume at minus 12 dBs and velocity to volume at 35%. Does that look suspicious? To me, yes, and that's why I decided to make an experiment to find out how it all actually works. But first, let's make a quick demonstration. Let me just load a sample to a default instance of Simpler and add a simple MIDI clip with 4 notes at different levels of velocity. Let's take a listen. They all sound different in volume, and this is exactly what we expect from velocity. Now, let's turn velocity to volume to a minimum and run the clip again. See? Velocity stopped working and all notes sound exactly the same. Okay, now let's turn velocity to volume to a maximum and see what happens. What we hear is that MIDI notes again sound different in volume, but the difference became bigger. But did you notice anything else? Here, we've run into clipping. What is clipping? It happens when a signal is so loud that it exceeds the maximum possible loudness of an audio file. The signal just tries to jump through a ceiling and it can't. In DAWs, anything that is louder than plus 6 dBs is just lost, and in our case it was plus 21.5 dBs. Clipping not only results in a distorted signal that cannot be repaired afterwards, but it also can damage your professional audio speakers. That's enough arguments to take a little bit closer look at velocity to volume parameter, isn't it? For my test, I needed to create 11 MIDI tracks with 11 instances of Simpler and 11 MIDI clips. These clips contained one MIDI note each, and I had to make equal velocity level to all of them for each test run. All instances of Simpler were loaded with the same sample. I didn't care about the volume parameter of Simpler, so I set it to 0 dBs. I didn't need most of other default features, so I deactivated them. All I needed to explore was the behavior of velocity to volume parameter, and that's why I set it to values from 0% to 100% with a step of 10%. And that is the only difference between these 11 tracks. Then I would run the project for velocity levels 1, 11, 21, 31, and so on up to the 127, which is the maximum possible velocity value, and read the peak volume levels of each track. One important note if you want to run the same test yourself. Velocity to volume parameter doesn't change the initial sample. It adds or removes volume T from it. That's why I had to remove the samples on volume from the peaks to get the proper results. So, for example, if my sample peaks at minus 2 dBs and my track's peak is minus 6 dBs, I had to calculate the difference and write down the balance, which is minus 4 dBs. In short, I got a lot of numbers, so let's take a look at the charts now. This one shows what happens to notes with minimum velocity. Their volume is going down to negative values as velocity to volume grows. And this one shows what happens to notes with maximum velocity. Their volume is going up along with velocity to volume level. Actually, this cone contains all the possible volume levels that can be made by all the combinations of MIDI notes velocities and velocity to volume levels. So the first question would be, is there a velocity level where volume stays the same no matter what velocity to volume is set to? The answer is yes, and the closest velocity value is 69. That basically means that all notes with velocity below 69 get a volume cut, and all the notes with velocity above 69 get a volume boost. So the next question would be, how much boost or cut? We can see that at any given level of velocity to volume, there is a different volume range between minimum and maximum velocity levels, and it is expanding as the velocity to volume is going up. If we divide this volume range by 127, we will find out the impact of minimal velocity change to MIDI note's volume. Therefore, we can say that velocity to volume parameter controls the sensitivity of MIDI note's velocity. Roughly, if we change velocity by 1, we will change the volume by 0.04 dBs at 10% of velocity to volume, 0.08 dBs at 20% of velocity to volume, 0.2 dBs at 50% of velocity to volume, and 0.4 dBs at 100% of velocity to volume. Just to make sure that we can trust this data, let's add the missing velocities to the chart. At maximum velocity to volume, 10-step change in velocity leads to approximately 4 dBs change in volume, well, which is 0.4 dBs per step of 1. And that means that yes, we have quite trustful results. The next question is, can you make up any formula for volume change calculation? In fact, yes, because if you look closely, all our dependencies are linear. We know that maximum volume change per 1-step change of velocity is 0.4 dBs. And we know that notes at velocity 69 get constant volume across all settings of velocity to volume. So we probably can write the formula as 0.4 multiplied by velocity minus 69 and multiplied by velocity to volume. Remember, we should care about clipping, and that's why we need to control the loudest notes, which are the ones with velocity 127. And therefore, the formula can be simplified. 23.2 multiplied by velocity to volume. That means that when velocity to volume is set to 100%, Simpler boosts the volume of loaded sample by 23.2 dBs, which is huge. And that is the reason why we ran into clipping. We just added too much. And that is the reason why Simpler loads with those default parameters, 35% of velocity to volume and minus 12 dBs at volume. This is just gain reduction, a simple way of escaping clipping. There are two ways now. You can use the formula for gain reduction calculation and use it every time you need to adjust velocity to volume. And I know that some producers like to put it to 50 or 60%, for example. Or you can learn how to set up a macro so that you can put this parameter fully under your control. Here is how you can do that. Let's load a default instance of Simpler to a MIDI track and set its parameters velocity to volume and volume both to zero. Now I'm going to make it as a group because this will give me the option of creating macro controls. Now I'm going to open a macro view and set velocity to volume to the first macro. You can see that now I can use the macro to change velocity to volume parameter. What I'm going to do now is to set volume to the same macro control. I suggest we get some little bit of extra headroom and set maximum gain reduction at 23.5 dBs and not at 23.2 dBs. I'll open the map and change minimum and maximum values of volume attenuation to minus 23.5 and 0 respectively. I need to reverse this parameter's behavior so that if we increase the velocity to volume, the volume should go down and vice versa. You can see that now when velocity to volume is set to 100%, the volume parameter goes down to minus 23.5 dBs. And when velocity to volume is set to 0%, the volume is set to 0 dBs. This method lets you keep velocity and velocity to volume fully under control. You can do the same thing using Ableton Racks where macro view is enabled by default. And don't worry if you have more than one sample in a rack. Just Google it, how to edit values of multiple samples in racks, and you'll be good to go. And by the way, don't be confused that the combined macro seems to be changing only in range of 1 to 127. You can easily put any decimal number here for better precision if you need so. I really hope this video was helpful to you. Please let me know in the comments if you have any questions. And as always, thanks for watching and I will see you in next videos. Bye bye!